3, 2, 1.
Brought to you by the International Rugby League Supporters Federation. My name's Rob Corra. I'm your host for this month's show. And this month, well, the 16th edition of the Rugby League World Cup has been completed. And we thought we should take a close look at what has occurred in this World Cup. To do this, we're going to speak to Phil Kaplan. Phil has written a number of books on rugby league. He's also the managing editor of 4020 magazine. So, Phil, welcome to Rugby League Fanfare.
It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you so much for asking.
Phil, I just wanted to start off by asking you about the postponement of this competition. Of course, this World Cup was supposed to be staged last year. So did the postponement have an impact on the World Cup?
I guess it had to have done. I mean, clearly the window it had in 2021 was almost bespoke. There was no other competing international competition around it. The government funding that had been guaranteed and the personnel that had been employed by Rugby League World Cup 2021 was all in place, and that had to be altered. Every contract had to be renegotiated. There were a lot of logistical issues finding a space between the Commonwealth Games and the Soccer World Cup. So, yes, it had an impact in terms of the extra year's build-up for the infrastructure over here. Probably not as much as you would think. I think the extra time allowed the organisers to put in place a little bit more of the underpinning to make sure it was a success. I think looking at how the competition panned out from a playing point of view, it would have been very difficult to go ahead without Australia and New Zealand and sides from the Pacific denuded of their best players. That's what's made it the triumph that it is. And I make no apologies for saying that, because I'm a passionate internationalist and I think it worked on virtually every level. So yes, it had an impact. Did it spoil the competition? Now it's finished. Ultimately, no.
All right. Okay. I just thinking overall about this World Cup, about all the aspects that make up a Rugby League World Cup, what did you like about the World Cup competition overall?
I think the highlight was what was promised right at the very beginning, that it would be the most inclusive one we'd ever seen. And to have the women's, the wheelchair and the men's side by side, and to the last image of this World Cup to be all those three teams lifting their trophies simultaneously at Old Trafford was probably the biggest highlight. Of the three, the around the water cooler moment has undoubtedly been wheelchair rugby league. And that's made people talk about the sport who normally would have no association with it or interest in it. There's massive potential as well for how that spreads, and its geographical footprint could be completely different from the men's running game, which has always been like the brand leader, if you want to call it that. Yeah. So I think, again, the men's competition had two aspects to it. I think the group stages, we needed to tell stories, and to have the likes of Greece and Jamaica and Lebanon there was fantastic. That enabled us, irrespective of results, to tell wonderful tales about some of the great characters within rugby league. And we got the chance to interview players from, you know, the domestic competition in Greece and in Jamaica, and we got to talk to heritage players about how much that meant to them. I think when we got to the quarterfinal stages, then we got much more competitive games, and that happens with every global tournament. Yep. So we shouldn't apologise for that. I think the quarterfinal between Samoa and Tonga with the simultaneous Civitau and Sipitau really set that part of the competition up. And again, the semi-final between Australia and New Zealand men was almost for us here in the Northern Hemisphere, like seeing Origin in our back garden. So that was fantastic. And then I think to get almost 70,000 people at Old Trafford for the men's and women's finals when England weren't playing was also a triumph. The wheelchair was best summed up, I think, by the Americans. I think their story in the group stages was absolutely fantastic. What they're hoping to do now on the back of that to almost establish a domestic game of rugby league, and the wheelchair as it's played is nothing other than a variant of rugby league. It can't be anything else. So if we can get a domestic footprint on the back of that, they're talking also about helping nations like Mexico and Canada establish teams. New Zealand are clearly looking at having a wheelchair team. I think they're more advanced post this World Cup than they were, and Wales are about to tour Brazil with a wheelchair tour in February. So that's all looking positive. I don't know if you saw the final between England and France, arguably the best game of the World Cup. You know, had absolutely everything. Low scoring, high drama. BBC Two television here stayed on air for an extra half an hour just to get in the celebrations and the interviews. That's never happened before. And having all 61 games on the BBC free to air has been massive as well. And then in the women's competition early on, the story of Brazil was inspirational. I think it reminded all of us why we fell in love with the sport in the first place. Just so refreshing the way they approached it. And the New Zealand-Australia women's game in the group stages in York, arguably the best women's game we've ever seen on soil in this country as well. And even though the final was a bit of a blowout, there was much to admire. So, yeah, that's a small snapshot of what we've enjoyed over the last 6 weeks.
And, all right, conversely, what didn't you like about the World Cup?
I think there were some logistical issues with ticket sales and I think an access to websites saying that tickets were sold that weren't, which was partly to do with the fact that the competition sales started in 2019 before we'd had a pandemic, before we'd had a cost of living crisis that we've got here. There are lots of tickets were allocated to service workers in 2019 who I don't think 3 years down the line turned up, which is understandable. There was a problem with merchandise. I think there were a lot of people would have loved to have bought a Papua New Guinea shirt after the way we saw them play and approach the games, but you just couldn't get hold of one. So that was an issue. Other than that, I think you can always find gripes with any competition. Look at the FIFA World Cup in Qatar at the moment. Yes. I think you've got to look at the legacy of what we can now build on for the international game. And arguably the platform is as strong as it was after 2013, which is hailed as possibly the best World Cup we staged over here.
Okay, and what about the crowds for this tournament? Do you think you've just hinted there that the crowds may have been affected by the postponement. I imagine there must have been some sort of loss of ticket sales. People probably bought tickets to matches and, they couldn't get to see the games because of, the postponement. But the overall crowds, do you think they were satisfactory, the crowds and the venues?
I think there's two ways of looking at this. One of it is you've got to look at the television viewing figures.
Yes.
Because this is the first time that every single game has been available free to air. So it's very easy to, look at the rain outside or decide you're not going to travel to Middlesbrough or wherever it might be, but you can still see the match. Whereas in 2013, there were only six games live on free to air. You had to subscribe to get the others and you didn't always get the same quality of coverage that we've now come to expect. So I think if you look at the overall viewing figures, which have been really, really encouraging, over 20 million people have watched matches, and in the latter stages of the competition, some record-breaking figures for women's and wheelchair attendances broke records everywhere they went. The final was a record for that. Clearly, the opening doubleheader for the women's game at Headingley, that was a record in the Northern Hemisphere for women's only matches, and the final again, the women were playing in front of a record crowd at Old Trafford in this part of the world. So I think it depends on how you want to look at it. 80% of the games had to be scheduled in the north of England. That was contingent upon the government funding, which was for something over here called the Northern Powerhouse and a levelling up agenda, which never actually really happened politically and is another debate. But that's what the money was granted for. So the bulk of the games were always going to be played in the north of England. But there were successes outside of it. 45,000 in Newcastle for the opening day with half of the crowd from the northeast region. Middlesbrough had nearly 9,000. There were over 40,000 at Arsenal the first time. Obviously, we've taken a World Cup game there and first time there's ever been a game at the Emirates Stadium. And I say the Old Trafford crowd for the final approaching 70,000. You can pick out odd grounds and odd games where you thought perhaps there were less there than maybe you would have liked. But there were cheap tickets available at every ground. I think the only other issue that perhaps the organisers will address in their review over the next couple of weeks is that they were selling, they were saying venues were sold out when they actually weren't, and I think that might have put a couple of people off.
Well, sort of, you know, I was just sort of, I just went through the ground, the crowd figures there at the end of the tournament, and for instance, I mean, I know it was midweek, Australia versus Italy at St Helens. I mean, I thought would have thought that. Well, you know, Australia playing at St Helens, there would be a sort of a fairly decent crowd. But, you know, 5,500 for an Australian match at St Helens, I thought was a bit disappointing. I mean, I know that there has been criticism over here that the Australians didn't really go out of their way to promote the competition. Would you agree with that?
No, I think they played a game in Coventry against Scotland, which to all intents and purposes, again, was a foregone conclusion in terms of the result. Yes. But over 12,000 people attended. The Aussies went down there for 3 days, did a lot of work with the local chambers of commerce and in some of the junior clubs down there. So, no, I think what we've managed to do maybe is re-establish the Kangaroos brand and tell everybody that it is, you know, a world-leading one. And the Australians now just need to play more because clearly there's a lot of people over here that have forgotten the excitement of a Kangaroo tour. They haven't seen the bulk of these players play in the flesh because we've got out of the habit of doing so. I mean, my association predominantly is with Leeds, and we went to Headingley for the first game between Australia and Fiji. That's the first time the green and golds have been on the famous Headingley pitch since 1994. Okay. That's almost a generation of people, probably slightly more. And again, you've got to show people in the flesh just how good the Aussies are, and perhaps they haven't done it enough. And this is now the debate that we have to have after every World Cup about how do we get international fixtures established whereby we can now look forward to a Kangaroo tour in probably 2024.
Yes.
And we can build up to that and make sure that all the grounds are full when they arrive.
The only other thing that I noticed was Fiji as well. No matches for Fiji in Rochdale. I mean, there's a sort of a historical link between Fiji, the nation, and Rochdale, well, the club there, Rochdale Hornets, and that sort of thing. I sort of thought that would have been nice for the Fijians to play at Rochdale, but they didn't seem to work that into the schedule.
That was a casualty of moving it from 2021. England was supposed to be playing Fiji in a warm-up game in Rochdale last year to celebrate their 150th anniversary. But since then, obviously, the Rochdale club shares its ground with the football club. I think there are some domestic arrangements there that perhaps aren't quite as cordial as they were a year ago. And that game was moved to Salford. And I believe that was one of the reasons why Fiji, in fact, didn't play a World Cup game there.
All right. Okay. And you've spoken there earlier about the BBC coverage. I mean, this was, as you said, a massive plus for the game and like very good figures. My understanding is that even for some of the lower matches that they got very good audience figures for even, well, as you mentioned there, Australia and Scotland and so forth. Just reading over here that there were quite high viewing numbers for even some of the lower matches.
Absolutely. I think it really caught the imagination, and the catalyst for that, I believe, was the wheelchair game. Some of the matches were mid-afternoon. It got a new audience. Social media was awash with what was happening. So many people hadn't come across this kind of sport before where there's a brutal edge to it, you know, no quarter given. And it just came over. I think the great thing about wheelchair is it's very similar to the evolution of snooker when that first became a television sport, that the action is encapsulated within the screen. There's nothing that you need to know or see outside of what's happening. And even though the games had some wide margins at the beginning, the collisions and the stories of the people behind who was playing it were fantastic. And that really took off from a television sense. And because it was woven into the women's and the men's, there was a spillover. So, yes, the viewing figures were brilliant. I think The viewing figures for the wheelchair final were something like 1.2 million with a peak of 2 million. For the men's semi-final involving England and Samoa, yep, that was something like 2.5 million. I mean, these again are television, yep, viewing figures that we can't buy over here in the Northern Hemisphere with all our rugby league predominantly, yep, on you know, Sky. So I think in terms of television and the image it gave and the documentaries that ran alongside and the fact that the coverage always started at least half an hour to an hour earlier than the matches, which allowed some sort of build up. Yeah. We had Andrew Voss over here doing the World feed and the Fox feed, which again just gave it a different feel.
Yes.
So we're nothing but praise for the BBC, and obviously they also had radio backing that up as well. Yeah. And we were getting stories on radio channels and on bulletins that again don't normally cover rugby league. So yeah, media presence probably 8 or 9 out of 10.
I mean, for me, yes, I'm sort of like in the category that you're a fan that you're talking about, because I'd never seen a wheelchair rugby league. So to see it for the first time, it is a bit of a sort of, I suppose you'd say, a crash 'em up derby in a way. But there's a great deal of sort of, I suppose there's a great deal of gymnastic type, the way they sort of duck and weave to avoid being tagged, so to speak, you know, to have their tag taken off them. It's not just a crash 'em up derby. There is a great deal of skill involved in this game as well. Some of the ridiculous passes that were thrown and so forth. But as you said as well, the final itself was the best final of the competition. And England defeated France by 28 points to 14. France, of course, were the holders of this tournament. So that's an initial success for the English team in wheelchair rugby league. And I really do hope, even here in Australia, I hope that there is more sort of coverage now of the game over here. I'm very hopeful that Fox, maybe, I don't think Channel 9 would do it, but possibly having sort of some sort of coverage over the game here, because I thought the women's game was sort of like the future of rugby league, but I'm now sort of thinking that wheelchair rugby league is the future of the game. I really think it has got great possibilities, as you pointed out there.
Well, the interesting thing about wheelchair is that the power of the sport at the moment rests in the Northern Hemisphere, yes, which is the exact opposite to the running game. France invented the game and England helped them refine the rules, and they played in the last three World Cup finals. And it's, yes, safe to say there is a genuine animosity between the nations, which is fantastic. It's a real rivalry. It almost is on a par with the Ashes rivalries we used to have in the running game. So there is an onus now upon Australia, who were the only Southern Hemisphere team in the competition, to actually help develop it, because they want to play other nations. They want to play Pacific nations. They want to play New Zealand, because that's how they're going to improve. And again, talking to the Australian team management after they got to the semi-finals, they were saying they thought they knew how the game was played, but coming over to the Northern Hemisphere and seeing the elite teams here play it, they realise now that it's a different game. So the onus in some ways is on Australia to help now develop what is a new marketable product. And I know that clearly and understandably, the likes of Peter Valandis and Andrew Abdo are very precious of the running game and the value that that has. But they've always looked for something that they can cash in on, a new part of the sport that perhaps doesn't have a television contract attached to it already. And yes, if they can see the value of wheelchair, it could very much be that. And again, Troy Grant of the International Rugby League is talking about the Olympics being in Brisbane in 2032 and wheelchair perhaps being a part of that, either as an integral sport or a demonstration sport. And again, if we are starting to look further ahead and a possible legacy from this World Cup and what it might bring, then, you know, we should be planning for that now and not waiting until, yes, 2031 and deciding, oh, how are we going to get teams over here and who's going to be playing in it? There is a huge reservoir of untapped talent in wheelchair rugby league that there isn't over here in the running game at the moment. So, yes, yes, it's got massive potential for the sport, not just for any individual competition.
Yeah. All right, in the women's competition, as you pointed out there earlier, the final, Australia defeated New Zealand by 54-4 in the final. What was your opinion of the English team's performance in this competition, in the women's competition?
I think they did as well as could be expected.
Yep.
Getting to the semi-final, they were either going to play Australia or New Zealand. I think we've all watched in awe and admiration over here what's happened with the NRLW and how that's been developed and the resources put behind it and the athletes that play it. And I think we thought that if England could be competitive in a semi-final, then that would show an indication of progress from the last World Cup in 2017. Clearly, we've got the Women's Super League here, but it's not as advanced as the NRLW. There isn't the same pool of players to choose from. There's effectively three great teams and probably one behind them. So we're selecting from a much more restricted pool. And I think against New Zealand in the semi-final at York, England were very competitive. You can always look at an individual game and say perhaps they needed to do a little bit more in terms of maybe having greater options on the bench to try and change the game. But overall, they were a lot fitter than they've ever been. They were better prepared than they've ever been. They had some standout players during the competition, but they don't play at that level often enough to be able to compete over a full 80 minutes. And I actually don't know how much that game took out of New Zealand and maybe even accounted for what happened in the final. But no, I think England women, everything as expected of them, they achieved.
Yes, well, I thought in the semi-final you just mentioned there that, England definitely did have their chances, but unfortunately, they just kept on dropping the ball. I thought the kicking game as well wasn't their kicking game as well. Unfortunately, kicking has become a major part of the game, and they didn't have a very good kicking game there. They had their chances in that semi-final, but just too many mistakes at crucial games cost them. Phil, the women's competition over here is expanding now to 10 teams. There's going to be 10 teams. There's four new teams coming in for next season's competition. Do you think it'd be worthwhile if some of the English women came over here? I'm sure that the
Yeah, I think it'd be fantastic. I mean, not only would it be a wonderful life experience for them, but again, I think the England's men's team has slightly regenerated, particularly under Wayne Bennett initially, when it had players it could bring back from the NRL to bolster the team here. One of the problems we have over here is the same that we've had probably for the last 50 years, is that our domestic competition is not intense enough. We don't have a state of origin either. So we don't have that stepping stone that you need in international rugby league. We're hoping, that the French will improve, and by playing them more regularly and having Catalan Dragons and very briefly Toulouse in the Super League, that there are more professional rugby league players playing in France. But we just haven't got that element of being able to step up on the biggest stage. So you would hope that the next thing the women need here clearly is compensation for expense, so that they're not out of pocket to play the game, which they have been. We need a bigger pool of talent across the country. We don't have to restrict it to the north of England, to make sure that more women who've seen the game get a chance to play the game, and obviously can be upskilled and perhaps have an international element, but also that some of our top players can find a place in the NRL. There's a young standoff called Georgia Roach. She's yes. only in her early 20s. She was the woman of steel when she was 16 over here. She's clearly talented and at the moment doesn't have familial ties. Because the other thing, of course, with the women's game is it's more than just they play rugby league. They play rugby league as a recreation. A lot of them are mothers, have very good jobs. It's very hard for them to uproot and come to Australia. But some of the younger players, Fran Goldthorpe would be another example, who haven't got those ties yet. And on the verge of perhaps being something really special, could and should go and test themselves if that opportunity arrives.
All right. In the men's competition, I'm very interested to know what's been the reaction to England's loss in the semi-final to Samoa.
Usual amount of breast beating. I think it was anticipated that England perhaps would be playing Tonga, which would have been a repeat of that wonderful semi-final in 2017. I think had England played Tonga and lost in that game, there would have been an element of reason to that. But Samoa offered them an opportunity to make the final on home soil. And this is the third tournament running played on home soil that England have not made the final. So that's got to go down as a disappointment. And clearly, I think the manner of the way they played Golden Point extra time against Samoa, having clawed it back to 26 all, perhaps undeservedly, you thought that, well, the psychological advantage would be with England. And if they could have just kept their cool and their calm in Golden Point, they may have scraped a victory. Everybody would have said, what a fantastic performance by Samoa. But England would have made the final against Australia. And that, I think, was a minimum requirement. To lose that game in the manner in which they did, with a team where I think at least a third of them have probably played their last international game. Yeah, there will be a review, questions will be asked, and that whilst it was a magnificent game, and the story of Samoa then became a great story of a Pacific nation, a Tier 2 nation, reaching a World Cup final for the first time. There was intense media disappointment here that all the national papers that don't normally cover rugby league that had allocated space to build up a World Cup final for the week beforehand, to all intents and purposes, dropped the sport because England weren't in it, and that was a big disappointment.
Well, did the coach Shane Warne, did he pick the right players? Do you think there was sort of I remember reading articles saying that he's gone for a it's a fairly older squad. Do you think he picked the right players?
Well, hindsight's a wonderful thing. I think there were concerns that he was heavily reliant on the way Wigan played when he coached them, which was successful. And some of the players within that Wigan team who were at the older age end that he brought back, and that there wasn't enough variety. I think that it's very hard in modern day rugby league to go without two hookers. I think that limits you then, because whoever your hooker is too easy a target. And he went with Michael McAlorum, who was in his fourth World Cup, who is a tough defender, but doesn't run with the ball. And then he moved Victor Radley into the hooking role as an auxiliary, having already made 30 tackles. So he didn't bring speed and agility off the bench in that role. I think that was felt to be a concern before the tournament. But of course, when you're winning and winning well to get to the semi-final, he is justified. It was exposed in that semi-final, and I think there will be questions asked. Clearly, Sam Tompkins he wanted as his captain, but he didn't look fit throughout the entire tournament. He'd had injury worries leading into it, and again, because Sam was out there right until the end, it felt as though Jack Welsby, who I think is going to be captain in 2025, was a little bit of a fish out of water playing at standoff 5-8. So again, there wasn't the ability to move and change things around enough that he picked four forwards on the bench against Samoa who were always going to come on and do your job, shoring the team up. But if you were already behind by then, didn't offer you enough to actually win the game. So yeah, there'll be some question marks. I think England now need to look at 2025. The next World Cup is obviously a shorter time frame than we would normally have. I think that there perhaps does need to be a conscious effort to bring more of these younger players in and give them responsibility over what will be a limited number of games between now and then. Whether that needs the same coach with the philosophy he's got or a different one, that again, and who that different one would be, that is going to be an interesting review for the RFL to have.
And Phil, the international board has got big things to consider now, because clearly they will have to reconsider the status of nations like Samoa and perhaps Tonga as well.
Now, I'm not sure they do, because the criteria are pretty strict about what you need to be a Category A team. It's not just your international performances. It's about the strength and depth of your domestic competition. It's about the organisation. It's about the amount of commercial income you can bring into the sport. So I don't think either of those two nations are anywhere near being Tier 1 nations in their entirety. What we are getting, though, is a World Cup before it kicked off where six nations could genuinely say they might make the final. and the first chance that we've seen a tier two Pacific nation get to a final. I think that's what we need to build on and not worry too much all about. Right. What their class does. Also, that brings in the debate of origin about if they are tier one nations, their players couldn't play in origin, but is one of the reasons they are now able to play at that level of intensity because their players have been exposed to origin. It probably is. I think we do need to look at playing more test matches in those regions. I think they've all got at least one ground where they could host one. I think when we looked at PNG, they are massively improved. That's the best PNG team I've ever seen, and it's no coincidence that is on the back of having the Hunters in the QRL for the last 8 years. I think Fiji again are talking about that there isn't a link yet between the Silverbacks and the NSW competition. They need to get that established, that they're working in opposite directions, but they need to get that worked out, and that will benefit their team. And there's absolutely no reason why we can't look at the 2029 World Cup and say that should be a Pacific event with the bulk of the games played in New Zealand, but group games involving Tonga and Fiji and Samoa and PNG played in their country. And I think once you've got to that 7 years down the line and we see how those respective nations are doing, then you can look at reclassifying them perhaps. But what we need to do is, yeah, we've all revelled in seeing the pictures coming in from all around the world of Samoans who perhaps wouldn't even have come across rugby league before. But I've seen that their nation, their little dot in the ocean has firmly been established because of what their rugby league team have done. And again, I think the other highlight, to go right back to the beginning, the highlight of the competition was The Rock sending out his message to Samoa a couple of days before the final. I mean, he's got 350 million people on Instagram that follow him. Yep. I'm pretty sure before he was told that his nation were in a Rugby League World Cup final, he probably didn't know what Rugby League was, but he talks about it as though he did and also what it meant. And I think that's what we need to capitalise on rather than obsess with what tier the nations are in.
All right. OK. And of course, Australia win the 2022 Rugby League World Cup by defeating Samoa 30 points to 10 in the final. It was a final that, well, I think the final score probably didn't reflect the match itself. Samoa, especially when an Australian player was sent to the sin bin there, I thought they had some chances to get back into the game, but unfortunately they missed those chances. And then, of course, to counteract that, Cameron Murray did score a try whilst they were a player down, and that effectively ended Samoa's hopes. But,
Australia were always the better team, but I think that sin binning did alter the game on both sides. On the Australian side, their defence, which had been so good throughout the tournament, just shut up shop. They were, you know, to not concede when you're down a man and look actually stronger is an amazing attribute. But the player who had to go off because he failed his HIA was the only hooker that Samoa had. They'd lost two during the competition, and they needed Chanel Tavita Harris to be out there for the full 80 minutes. When he went off and Anthony Milford had to go into that role, they lost a playmaker, and they just couldn't throw enough really at Australia in the closing stages like they did against England. I think that altered the margin of the result, but clearly Australia were the best team in the competition. But Samoa and the way they went about their business, and when you consider that in their first game they were absolutely obliterated by England to make the final and become competitive in that final, it's an astonishing story.
That in itself, I did say I have some comments to make in the previous program there about the embarrassment, the ease of a lot of England's tries in that first match was a definite worry, but it's a massive turnaround for Samoa from that first match. Phil, they're saying that this competition is going to make a profit. How do you think these profits should be spent? I know that the competing teams have been guaranteed certain amounts, and of course I hope they all do get those certain amounts, but any profits from this competition, how would you like to see them spent?
Well, I think that that profit is guaranteed because it's a cost neutral competition. Built into the cost is a fee to the International Rugby League. Nobody will tell us how much that fee is. And also built into the cost of the competition are all the men, women and wheelchair getting participation fees for the first time. So that has happened. And they were all put up in either 4 or 5 star accommodation. So again, I think in terms of looking after the players, that has happened. All those promises have been kept. Clearly, the fee that has been agreed to stage the competition has been met. So there is money in the coffers of the IRL. And it, now it's a question of how can they best spend that to make sure that the nations over the next 3 years get the best possible chance of building up to make France even bigger and better than this one has been. Clearly, you can cover some costs of internationals between now and then. I'd like to see that tied into development grants. So, for example, Jamaica desperately need land. And each individual nation needs something different as to where they are in their stage of development. But Jamaica have got a pool of domestic players, but nowhere to actually play and call their own. They're always trying to lease or borrow pitches. So they need somewhere, ideally in Kingston, the capital, where they can put up a sign that says Jamaica Rugby League Association. They can play their grand finals there. They can use it 7 days a week, 365 days a year, purely to help foster rugby league on the nation. Now, if that were to cost, say, and I'm clearly making up a figure here because I have no idea what land values are in Jamaica, £250,000, you know, you'd look at their performances in the World Cup. You'd say, right, well, if you've got a board of directors there that we could pay this grant over to that can solely be used for the purchase and establishment of a base in the island, some of the profits for me should be used on that basis. Similar in Brazil, you know, distance is an issue in Brazil. Talking to some of the girls who came over, that they couldn't train together as regularly as they'd like to because of the enormous distances between the north and the south of the country. Again, if they could establish somewhere where they could call, you know, a centre of excellence, and and that again was going to cost £250,000, and they're already guaranteed a spot in the next World Cup, and they could say, right, well, the metrics show that if we had somewhere, we could almost double the amount of participants that are playing in the sport. Then again, I think these are the projects we should be funding. And you know, if we're talking about having a qualifying competition for men and women in Africa, and it might need some money towards that to bring everybody to a location in Africa, and they don't have to pay their own travel expenses to get there, then these are all the things I think we should be funding. Just paying more players or staging more games and paying for the staging of those games is probably not the answer. It's infrastructure. One of the other things that has been a success of this World Cup has been that over £20 million of government money has been put into community facilities in England, where rugby league clubs that are either already established are upgrading their grounds, or clubs that don't have them are being able to put down roots for the first time. And, you know, that's incalculable until those clubs have been in operation for the next 4 or 5 years and you can see if the numbers have gone up. But I think that's what the profit should be spent on. And it is there.
I've got to say that this is one of the things that just watching some of the matches here in Australia and seeing some of the facilities that are available, you know, some of the grounds, for instance, Doncaster, I know Doncaster are in the lower divisions there in the English Rugby League now, but it looked like a really nice ground, the Doncaster ground there, mate. You know, so that, yes, I agree with you. Yeah, putting money into those sort of facilities is a definite plus. Phil, 2025 in France, what are you looking forward to?
Well, the first thing is it's in France. So in terms of food and drink, we're going to be well served there. That is a nation that certainly is the leader in the culinary world. Not that obviously we should march on our stomachs, but I'm looking forward to that. Again, we need some more detail. We need to know where the games are going to be played, over what distance. They were very, very ambitious when they announced the World Cup, saying that they wanted now 16 team in nations in the women, 16 in the wheelchair, and they're going to run a a youth competition alongside an under 19 level. That's fantastic. But obviously, what you don't want is the competition stretched over 2 months and over too many geographical areas that people can't follow the competition from beginning to end. So I think we need some more logistical details about what it's actually going to entail. I think it is going to come on the back of the Rugby Union World Cup and then the Olympics in France. So the infrastructure is going to already be there, which will be a massive advantage. Clearly, we know that the southwest of France is the hotbed of the game. So you'd think that the bulk of the matches will be around there. But you'd also like to hope that maybe, you know, some group games involving France could be taken to Paris and perhaps the north, Lille, other cities that rugby league, you know, Marseille used to be a big rugby league city. So hopefully it'll be a regeneration of the sport in France. I think that needs to ally very much over here in the Northern Hemisphere with what do we want from our domestic competition and how does that domestic competition help the international game. So, you know, we foolishly dispensed with Toulouse after 1 year in Super League. Are we going to bring them back in some guise under either promotion or perhaps with the new franchising that IMG are talking about? And what are we going to do with teams in Wales? Is there an opportunity in Ireland and Scotland to get semi-professional sides started there before 2025? So, yeah, I'm hopeful that what we are doing is talking more about international rugby league, that in the not too distant future, clearly the European Federation has unveiled some of the competitions that are going to take place in 2023 and leading into qualifiers in 2024 for 2025. We now need that established in the Southern Hemisphere. And if maybe Samoa or the Kiwis are coming to England in 2023, the Ashes is coming in 2024, then that's what we need to build up to the World Cup in 2025 and beyond.
Phil, thanks so much for joining us here on Rugby League Fanfare for this World Cup review.
It's an absolute pleasure. Thank you for inviting me.
Excellent review of the 2022 Rugby League World Cup. And listen, if you want to get a hold of 4020 magazine that Phil is the editor of, just go to our website, www.rlfanfare.com. www.rlfanfare.com. We have the contact details there if you want to subscribe to 4020, an excellent rugby league magazine. If it's happening in rugby league, 4020 has got it covered. Now, very quickly, I just wanted to tell you about something else that has been occurring in international rugby league, and a very big thank you to our Indigenous correspondent Perry Johnson for this information, because Perry tells me that whilst the World Cup was taking place over in England, well, there was another World Cup taking place here in Sydney. Now, let me tell you about the lineup of nations that took part in this World Cup. Samoa, Cook Islands, Fiji, Malta, Ireland, South Sudan, North Macedonia, Italy, El Salvador, Argentina, Cambodia, Vietnam, Tonga, the Philippines. There was a team from the Mediterranean Middle East, a New Zealand Maori team, and of course the New South Wales Indigenous teams. Now, we're not talking here about the Soccer World Cup, we're talking about the Harmony Cup. This is a competition that's been going for 9 years. There's been a break in the competition because of COVID. But I remember Perry telling me about this competition many years ago when it first started. Back then, there was probably only about 100 people participating. Now, there are more than 650 players competing in the Harmony Cup. What is the Harmony Cup? Well, the Harmony Cup, I suppose you'd call it a celebration of different cultures that participate in rugby league. It's a family day out, all sorts of activities there for kids, and of course a smorgasbord of different food from all the participating nations. It's a nines tournament, okay? It's a nines tournament with boys and girls under 16. Boys and girls under 18s. There's also a senior men's tournament and a senior women's tournament. The New Zealand Maoris won the men's senior competition this year. Now, if you want to get more information about the Harmony Cup, don't go to the guy who's supposed to be organising it. Let me tell you that, because he's missing in action. But there is information about the Harmony Cup on the New South Wales Rugby League website, and there's even highlights of the Harmony Cup on YouTube. So you can go to YouTube and check out the highlights there. Don't forget, of course, you can also listen to Rugby League Fanfare on YouTube. All right, that's about all we have time for you this month, ladies and gentlemen. We hope you've enjoyed the show. In the meantime, you've been listening to Rugby League Fanfare, brought to you by the International Rugby League Supporters Federation. My name's Rob Corra. On behalf of President Bob Brown, this program was recorded in the studios of Undercover Music. Your producer is the Renata Jimenez. Until next month, may the force be with you.
Gearing up for the action, the feeling's still the same. You've got butterflies in the stomach, but your mind is on the game. Play this game of rugby league, some folks would think you're nuts, but it takes a lot of skill and just plain old-fashioned guts. So whether you're on the cricket ground, Lang Park or the bush, you've still got to run, you've still got to tackle, and the scrums have got the same push. You give it some, you give some more, and you really give your all. Playing rugby league football, it's the greatest game of all. Oh, there's nothing like the spectacle of a test match in full roar, with the forwards charging, backs are skipping, running at full bore. The Pommies and the Kiwis and the Proms all play real keen, but we take on all comers and Australia reigns supreme. So whether you're on the cricket ground, Lang Park or the bush, you still gotta run, you still gotta tackle, and the scrums have got the same push. You give it some, you give some more, and you really give your all. Playing rugby league football, it's the greatest game of all.
Oracle player just short of the quarter way, plays it to Lang, across field of Beeson, after Beeson turns it back to Lang. Lang gives it back now to Meninga, standing still. Meninga gives it back to Close, who has to reverse and go back in field. Chris Rose!